Beyond, and hello everyone. My name is Jonathon Dornbush, and this is Podcast Beyond, IGN's weekly PlayStation show covering all the latest and greatest in the world of PlayStation. Even if they didn't show up to E3, we've still got a lot to talk about when it comes to PlayStation. I'm joined this week to discuss it all by Mitchell Saltzman.
Hello, hello.
Hey, Mitchell. Lucy O'Brien as well.
Not as much as Xbox. Not as much as, like, Unlocked has got to talk about, though. Hey, like, we're a little bit like, you know, we've been throwing some scraps, and we're like, let's talk about it for an hour.
Feed us, PlayStation. No, it's not great right now. And we're also joined this week by Max Scoville.
Hey, everybody. Happy to be here.
Happy to have you here as well on this day after E3. And none of us had to take a flight. We're, of course, going to jump into, despite PlayStation not being at E3, there are still a lot of games that will be on PlayStation that we're going to talk about in the episode to come. But we're also going to jump into a little bit of discussion about, PlayStation's choice not to be at E3 again this year. Obviously, they skipped 2019. Everyone skipped 2020 because it didn't happen in all senses of that phrase. And a bit more. Before we get into it, though, I do want to do a very quick sort of news crunch, because there's actually been a lot of other stuff going on, but we have so many games to talk about. I just briefly wanted to mention one. I did an interview with the heads of Deviation Games, Dave Anthony and Jason Blundell, as well as Herman Holst from PlayStation, talking about their new partnership, which was announced at Jeff Keighley's Kickoff Live, I think was what that show was called. We talked a bit about their partnership, why they wanted to partner with PlayStation, how PlayStation treats its partners, because Herman has talked recently a lot about, you know, treating these partners like they would treat any of the first party studios, and a bit more. It was a really fun discussion, and I think you should definitely go check out the interview.
Those guys they worked on Call of Duty Zombies a lot, right?
Yeah. One of them was, I believe, director on Black Ops 1 and 2, and the other was the co-creator of Zombies. Yeah, they have a lot of, you know, story history.
I've definitely interviewed them at Comic-Con, and I think it was specifically about, like, the weirdest corners of that. Like, talking about, like, oh, you Jeff Goldblum's a magician and you're fighting, you know, robot zombies on the Titanic or whatever. It's like, yeah, I'm curious what they do.
It was a really interesting discussion, because they're actually, like, lifelong friends. They've been friends since they were, like, 16 years old, like teenagers. And they were talking about how they always, like, dreamed of being able to have their own studio, like, that ever since they've been wanting to get into game design, they wanted to have their own project and do their own thing. And so they were like, we loved working within, obviously, you know, a big franchise like Call of Duty, and what those constraints kind of allow you to do and get creative in. But they're really excited about doing something themselves that they create the constraints for. So we'll see what it is. But yeah, in addition to that, also just wanted to mention, there was news in the past week, as if this week wasn't busy enough, that Cyberpunk 2077 will return on the PSN on June 21st. This is, of course, still the PS4 version. And in fact, the announcement comment, I believe, from PlayStation was like, you should probably play this on a PS4 Pro or PlayStation 5. You should not play it on the base PlayStation 4, basically. We're still waiting on next-gen versions for those games, of course, but yeah, that we'll continue to cover that as we hear more about whatever the next-gen version of that game is. And PSVR is allegedly hitting in holiday 2022, so next year. This is from a report from Bloomberg, so we may see that next-gen VR headset pretty early in the life cycle of the PS5, as opposed to PSVR, I think, hitting 3 years into the life of the PS4. But yeah, we'll obviously touch on that more when we see the PSVR 2 and whatever they call it. But there are a ton of PlayStation games to talk about from E3, even though PlayStation wasn't there. So I thought the maybe best way to cover this would be, I had to clear my throat, would be to kind of mention a few of the big ones and also just get a sense of where you all are most excited about some of the games that we saw. So briefly, I want to start off on Final Fantasy Origin. Is it Strangers in Paradise? Strangers of Paradise? I don't have the full title in front of me. But this is a Final Fantasy game that was rumored before E3, kind of got leaked ahead of time, that is essentially a Souls-like-ish take on Final Fantasy. It's from Team Ninja. If you're watching the video version, you would have just seen their logo pop up. And so it's sort of been described as like a Neo-esque take on Final Fantasy. There's been a demo that was released on PlayStation 5 specifically, but like the trailer says, quite often, chaos reigned. And the demo the demo was unplayable for like 2 or 3 days. And unfortunately, it's now since been updated. It's not corrupted anymore. You can go play it. I've played a little bit of it. Mitchell, I know you've played a bit, so I want to start off with you. What did you think of the demo?
I actually played a lot of it. trying to capture a clean run where I did not die took me quite a while, actually. But yeah, it's exactly what it kind of advertises itself as. This is a Team Ninja take on Final Fantasy. And if you're familiar with Nioh, you know what Team Ninja doing a Souls-like kind of looks like. But this has a couple of really unique aspects to it. There's no stamina meter, for one. So you can kind of just wail on enemies without having to worry too much about, you know, tiring yourself out. Like most Team Ninja games, I feel like you kind of have to understand how to play this game in order to have fun with it. And I think the key to understanding it is the fact that you have like this parry button that basically allows you to parry mostly any attack. There's a couple of unblockable attacks, but if you parry an attack, it kind of depletes this meter that you have at the bottom. And if that meter gets depleted, you get staggered. So you basically are down for a free hit. And so it's kind of about balancing that level of defense with, you know, still being able to, you know, use all your own abilities that also take magic. There's a lot going on here. But once you figure it out, I feel like the combat is pretty fun. But you know, it's just an early demo. It really does feel like this is the kind of thing that you would be playing at E3 if you were on the show floor. So it was a little rough. The frame rate wasn't completely solid. But I'm interested in this. I think it's got a really cool job system that it's taking from the Final Fantasy RPGs and putting it into a Souls-like. So you can basically level up a certain job, and you can get skills on a skill tree. And then once you get to the bottom of that skill tree, you unlock a new set for that job. So you go from swordsman, and then you get to the bottom, and you can unlock the warrior job, which has its own skill tree. But once you switch to that class, you kind of reset your stats. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have to, you know, build a new tree that's going to eventually be better than the swordsman class. But you have to kind of, you know, work with that early process of being a little weaker than you would normally be. So yeah, it's fun. I think this game has a lot of potential, and I'm really excited to see how it develops. The story, they don't really do much with the story other than, you know, chaos. I must kill chaos. I am chaos.
Yeah. Well, I was gonna ask Mitchell, where does it sit tonally? You know, Final Fantasy is tonally to me quite distinct, and I don't, you know, I don't automatically pair it up with the Souls-like, right? It's a very kind of different property in my mind. And obviously, you know, just looking at this footage that we're seeing now, it looks very sort of moody and dark. And of course, you know, that is all part of Final Fantasy as well. But Final Fantasy is also quite silly and extremely, I'm saying over the top, and then I'm looking at this footage and it looks extremely over the top. But yeah, I guess my question is, like, tonally, what's the vibe?
It feels dark. There's no joy. There's no joy in this game. But you know, it is kind of that weird, you know, juxtaposition, because you do have like these really menacing looking creatures. You're grabbing wolves by the jaw and like breaking their bones when they try to bite you. But then you also have cactuars. You have these little weird cactus men that, you know, are like this and just have the same expression, shooting little cactus spines at you. So there is that kind of weird whiplash. Mm-hmm. I'm curious to see how the actual full game develops that. But this was pretty much all one speed, and it was just kind of dark.
So I messed around with the demo a little bit. This is a Mitchell Saltzman ass game for sure.
Mm-hmm. This is a Mitchell Saltzman ass game for sure.
Yeah. It's weird. I wasn't wild about it. One thing I was hearing is that like it's, people are saying it's like set at the end of Final Fantasy I. Like it's definitely I haven't played Final Fantasy I, which I think came out like 35 years ago.
Garland is the last boss of Final Fantasy I, I think, right?
Right. Yeah. Like spoilers for, you know, a thing that came out when Reagan was president or whatever. But it's weird because like, you know, Nomura said like it might not look like Final Fantasy, but the blood is in its veins. And I'm like, well, that, you know, you can have a blood transfusion that doesn't affect your appearance or personality. Like this is definitely feels like more of a Team Ninja game than a Final Fantasy game.
Right.
I think, mm-hmm. you know, the addition of stuff like Cactuars and like the job system is really cool. Yeah, this, I feel like if you didn't tell me this was Final Fantasy, I would probably never guess. I mean, you know, unless you saw a Cactuar or whatever, but like it's seems so much like a, you know, a Neo or a Devil May Cry type of thing. It's, I mean, I want to see what it's like if this is late game. I mean, this is obviously a demo. This isn't the entire world, but like if there's, you know, more colorful areas, you know, maybe something more nature-y than like a big wrought iron castle, you know, like it's just it's interesting. I mean, I don't know if I'll go with it. Like I'm curious what it is lengthwise, because it's a, you know, Final Fantasy games are usually what, like 70 hours. Yeah, they're up there.
Neo,
and like
Neo games are pretty lengthy too. They can get like upwards of 40 to 50 hours.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
on the first playthrough.
It'd be interesting. I guess I normally associate action games with being a little more
tighter.
You know, a little shorter. Yeah. I mean, you know, from Soulsborne games are kind of different because there is a fair amount of grinding. So I don't know. Mm-hmm.
I do think that the Final Fantasy aspects of this kind of play out in interesting ways. Like enemies have like little attack names that pop up when they're about to use an ability, which is kind of cool. So you can know like what you need to do to avoid it. And then, yeah, like it's being a mage is pretty cool because you bring up like when you're charging a spell, you bring up a radial wheel that lets you choose what element you want to use. And then the more you hold it down, you go from like fire to Fira to Faraga. So that the way the Final Fantasy aspects manifest in this game are actually pretty neat.
It reminds me of Revengeance, like Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, which was, you know, Kojima basically passing the franchise over to Platinum. And then they made a Platinum game that had enough Metal Gear sprinkled on top of it, but it was totally its own thing. Like it was not even trying to be a stealth game. This kind of feels like the same thing, where it's like this is a Team Ninja game, like through and through. It just happens to have some, you know, Final Fantasy cosplay going on.
Yeah, that's a really good comparison. That is exactly what like this game is. This game is the Final Fantasy what Metal Gear Rising was to Metal Gear Solid. It feels like
That feels like a really good shot. I only played maybe like a half hour, 45 minutes of the demo, but I was enjoying the gameplay, if not feeling very overwhelmed by all of it. As you were saying, Mitchell, like there's a lot to grasp. Even after it runs you through some tutorial stuff, I was kind of like, felt like it was just throwing so much of the gameplay at you. And obviously it wants to give you a taste of what the full game is, and it's a demo, so who knows how it'll play out in the full game. But I was intrigued by it enough to want to see the full thing more. I do agree with you. It was definitely running a little rough. It's a demo. But yeah, I do hope, to Max's point, we see more like colorful areas, because what I was seeing was very dark and gray. and like it's a series that can go so fantastical. I hope there's like an interesting balance. And I one last thing I think to point out about it, one of the weird critiques I saw going around was everyone was hating on the main character and bemoaning the fact that you'll have to be him throughout the whole game. You immediately get like so much armor. I never saw the dude's face, like even after like 20 minutes in. Like you can just, if you don't like him, you'll be wearing a helmet within like 15, 20 minutes. Do not worry.
You do still have to deal with him yelling every time he rips someone's head off in an execution, which happens a lot.
Hey,
he's a very angry boy.
Nomura said he wanted to make a game about an angry man. And, you know, finally, we have a story about an angry man.
I really, you know, there hasn't been enough angry men in the games. Yeah.
Yeah.
You should really get Michael Douglas from Falling Down to play it. That would be a hell of a shout into the Final
Fantasy
universe.
That's the kind of like a different sort of anger that I feel we don't really see enough of in video games. Like that's a more relatable anger to me.
Oh, no.
Bring on a Michael Douglas falling down game.
You gotta cause as much chaos without killing anybody, you know?
Right.
Like just go. You're gonna go shoot up the ceiling of a fast food restaurant, but not hurt anybody. Lady's gonna throw
knock
up her
over
salad.
As many convenience stores.
Cause a man to have a heart attack.
Lady's anyway, gonna throw up in his salad. I'll never forget.
Welcome to the Falling Down spoiler cast. bringing you the most relevant pop culture topics we can.
Now you're gonna die out here in that stupid little hat.
Anyway, moving on from there, a couple of the other games, I figure rather than going down the list I made, I do want to throw it to everyone, and Mitchell will come back to you just because you talked about playing the demo as well. But Lucy, what really struck you from this week of like a game coming to PS4, PS5 that you're interested in?
Well, I mean, we're going to touch on the big one, right? Like I'm not going to spoil that yet.
Hades. Yeah, no, we're going to touch on Hades, of course, but you should be excited for Hades coming on August. But yes, we'll get to the big one in just a second.
Okay. I want to say color me intrigued by Guardians of the Galaxy. I think, you know, like Avengers, it's promising to do a lot, and that frightens me a little bit, just because, you know, if you're sort of doing too much in a game with, you know, such an enormous sort of inbuilt universe, I worry that it can go a little off the rails. But what really struck me was the writing in this massive demo that we saw. Like, the writing was, I'm trying to find the person who actually wrote this game. The writing was exceptional. Like, I was really, it was so good that I was actually like, oh, okay. Like, this is something worth paying attention to, because if you don't get those characters right, it's embarrassing. You know what I mean? Like, these are characters that you can't get wrong, because it's comedy. It's like, it is comedy for the most part. And like this, okay, the writer on the, well, one of the writers, I presume the lead narrative designer is a woman named Mary DeMarle. Shout out to her, because this is, I was just so taken, taken aback by it in a good way. And so, you know, regardless of what sort of like gameplay, how that all pans out, like I'm really interested in this, just because it feels like Guardians of the Galaxy, right? It feels like an extension of that universe, character models notwithstanding. But yeah, I'm intrigued. I will definitely play this.
I'm really happy this is coming out soon. Like, I think one thing that really didn't do Avengers any favors was how long of a tail that was from announcement to actually being released. And then, you know, they're still kind of dropping new content here and there. The fact that this was managed, they managed to keep this a secret, and then they're like, hey, it's out, you know, what, October? Like, that's
October 26th.
Yeah,
that's huge.
Yeah.
That's great. I'm very excited about this. Also, like, I don't know how big this game is. I'm kind of hoping it's a shorter experience. I know that's blasphemous to say, but like, I feel like we grew up with licensed games that were, you know, fair. They were shorter. You know, it was like it was like a, you know, like reading a comic or watching a movie. Like, it was a more of a contained experience. And like, as much as, I guess I'd rather see more frequent Marvel games than really gigantic Marvel games. Like, I'd be super down if this is like, you know, a 15, 20 hour experience. It looks hilarious, or it sounds hilarious, I guess, which is really nice. It's kind of giving me some Mass Effect vibes, but like, Mass Effect for the most part is so self-serious. And this is like, I don't know, you're arguing with your idiot shipmates. I'm super down for that. Like, that's to have basically a dumber Mass Effect that's a little shorter, and it's also silly, and it's superheroes. I'm super down.
Totally. And it comes from, for those who don't know, it comes from Eidos, the Deus Ex developers. And so, yeah, we see a little bit of like character choice, and the developers have said that stuff will like, the end of the game will still be the end of the game, but like, you'll get to have different missions play out differently, have character interactions change, the way like your squad talks to you will change based on the decisions you make. Like, one that I think everyone has seen in the trailer and gameplay was like, you can choose whether or not to basically throw Rocket across a gorge to force him to do an action for you. And if you do throw him, he's not going to volunteer to do something later down the road or things like that. So there will be some changes there, but yeah, I'm all with you. I'm like cautiously optimistic as someone who has played and enjoyed parts of Avengers despite the structure of that game. All I ever wanted was short, contained, cool stories with Marvel characters. And if this can be that and kind of be what I hoped Avengers would be and show that it can work, I hope it can succeed in that way. Because, this partnership is ongoing.
They're doing something novel with, like, they have silliness, and they have what seems like unique mechanics. Like, the fact that you, during a fight, you can, like, you can give a pep talk or a speech to your team, and like, depending on what dialogue you choose, you can maybe inspire them to fight better and like have everyone have a buff, or you can just like put your foot in your mouth and you'll have a buff and the rest of them are like, what was that all about? And then there's the whole music thing. Like, they could easily be like, it is a completely straight lifted mechanics from everywhere else. We don't do anything out of the ordinary. It's just kind of like, you know, proven systems. Let's do it. But they're like getting a little bit weird and experimental with it, which I'm kind of down with. And like, I mean, We've seen licensed music in tons of games, and it totally makes sense here because, you know, what is it? Peter Quill has his Walkman full of, you know, classic greatest hits. And like, this is in this case, it seems like they're really, I guess, gamifying that, which is neat.
Yeah. Yeah, based on the team up moves, it's different music that plays and everything. Yeah, I am cautiously optimistic as someone who like dearly loves the version of the the Guardians that we have in the MCU and has enjoyed the comic runs that I've read of theirs. Like, I am all for them taking a risk on this group again and seeing if they can make a fun story, especially it seems like they're diving a little bit deeper into the lore for like villains and stuff. So if this is a great take and it surprises us all at the end of the year, I am all for it. We'll see how it goes. But moving on from there, Max, I did want to ask you as well, anything really stood out to you from the last week of games coming to PlayStation?
Oh man, I feel like if I say, I'm going to accidentally say something I thought was third party that is in fact a Game Pass exclusive. I don't know. I mean, the big one, the obvious one is the Elden Ring. Yeah. Like that's
we
the
can
one
get I'm to it. Yeah.
Should we just get into it? Oh, wait, wait, hold. Avatar, obviously. There's the
there
one.
You
yeah,
go.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right. What we were leading you to.
I didn't
want to.
I'm
tired.
We were gently nudging you towards Avatar.
So this is interesting because, like, I mean, obviously, I'm like, I like Avatar. I'm the only guy who likes Avatar. I feel like just being like, hey, it's Avatar is pretty cool. I get a lot of people who are like, you're the big Avatar fan. It's like, I can name probably three characters, but, like, it's become a running joke. I'm really curious what this actually winds up being there. I feel like they're saying a lot of stuff that makes it sound like exactly what I want. Like they're saying it's a first person story driven adventure that is open world. And I'm like, that sounds like a Far Cry game, but they didn't use the word single player. Mm-hmm. And I have a sneaking suspicion it's going to be a games as a service. Like I have a hunch because that's what, you know,
Ubisoft
Massive
does.
And, yeah. I mean, Ubisoft does it. Massive did it with Division, and it also like it's the most obvious thing you could possibly do, releasing a licensed game alongside movies that are coming out every 2 years for almost a decade. Mm-hmm. Like if you know, we used to see the days where it's like, oh, Batman Forever is coming out this summer, hopefully we have a Batman Forever Game Gear game by November so all the kids who love it can play, and you get like crappy shovelware like that. But in this case, it's like they've had plenty of time to figure out what an Avatar game is. And you know, obviously, the way games come out now is like they come out and you can keep adding to them. And that makes perfect sense to do like new content drops aligned with each new movie. I guess I would so much love this to be just a world that I go explore on my own. Like, I don't really want to have to buddy up with people and do like, you know, Navi raids or whatever. Like, I don't know what that I just hope they don't turn it into sort of like a Destiny like type of thing.
Well, but that's, Max, you could go back and play the 2009 single player video game.
I remember
seeing that at my first ever E3. I'm so old. And it was the most heavily guarded demo I've ever been in, like, before. I mean, obviously it was like my first E3, but there were like security guards with like guns, and James Cameron was there, and like you had to put your mobile phones in a bucket.
They might have been guarding James Cameron, actually. You know,
like. Well, very, very, very potentially. I mean, he was just at the show. I didn't actually see him in my demo, but I remember like it was demoed to me, and I was expecting it to be like this incredible, like the best thing I'd ever seen, just because of the secrecy surrounding it. And it just looked so average. I never ended up playing it, but by all accounts, it was very average.
Yeah. I'm like, the more I watch this trailer, the more in my head, and Max, I know we've joked about Avatar a lot on the show with you, but like the more I was watching the trailer, I'm like, should I go back and watch Avatar? Because I kind of like this. Like,
dude, Avatar on. Like, I feel like there's so many people who just have like really like sour memories about it, and it's easy to hate on something that's popular. I saw Avatar after everyone else did. I didn't even see it in theaters. I wound up like pirating it when I was unemployed and watching it on my laptop, which is not how James Cameron wanted you to see that movie. And then it was, I think, the first Blu-ray I got when I was like, I want to collect Blu-rays. And then I would just throw it on whenever I was having a party, because it's like one of those movies they show in Best Buy to show how pretty the TV is. And it's just, it's cool to look at. But like, as far as it being like video gamey, like it's so ripe for that. Like, and the first Avatar game came out before Ubisoft had a extremely proven formula for how to make a cool open world game. Like, we gripe a lot about, you know, them reusing the same mechanics, but like for the most part, you know, that kind of stuff works. Like having, oh, there's an outpost and you got to climb the thing to find the stuff. And then you go looking around for items, and there's like random, you know, emergent storytelling encounters because a tiger showed up and started biting everybody. In this case, it's a universe where you have these like, you know, giant people who have a connection to nature, which could amount to basically magic. They can like bond with animals. And at the same time, there are mechs and like, you know, quadcopters, and there's like military tech, and it's this entire giant, you know, crazy jungle universe filled with made up animals. And like all of that is completely ripe for gamifying it. Like, it's so, there's so much opportunity. And it's also like, again, there's one movie. It's not like Star Wars where they have to like go run it by story group. I mean, I'm sure they have to, you know, check with James Cameron, but like, it's kind of, it's a pretty, it's not a blank canvas, but it's a very big canvas to work on.
Yeah, Max, I don't know if I ever told you this, but we used to put Avatar on in the background at parties as well, because it was filmed in New Zealand, so all of my friends were extras in it. And so we'd get like, we'd get wildly, wildly drunk and then like pause on their scenes and be, because they were all like guards, and we'd pause on their scene and be like, oh, you dick, you look so serious. Like, that was like...
That's so
you just
funny.
Took the piss.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
See, that's a good reason to put on Avatar. I just was like,
that's a very, yeah.
I have this and a raccoon documentary. Which should I put on?
But no, I like, Max, I think you're totally right, especially for fitting the Ubisoft model. Like, it so absolutely is like, oh, you can find a different group of Na'vi a little off in the distance in this way. And there's like this herd of animals over here that you can go fight with. And there's a human compound that we have to go take down. Like, it so totally fits the model. And I think they've said like this will be on an unexplored area of Pandora's, and like we haven't seen it in the movie. But like, you're absolutely right. This is a thing where if Ubisoft, it succeeds and Ubisoft is like, oh, hey, for Avatar 3, we're adding a new expansion where you go to the area in Avatar 3. Like, they can just do that. And it makes sense, especially this will be PC and next gen only. It's not coming to PS4 and Xbox One era consoles. So hopefully it's a little bit future proofed.
Yeah, it's a next gen game. Oh,
yeah.
Pro tip. If anybody wants to go rewatch Avatar, watch the director's cut, because it has like, you know, extra bonus scenes or whatever, but it also sort of contextualizes what Earth is like, which I don't think is in the regular theatrical version. And it's not like a 4-hour cut. It's, I think it's just like an extra 10 or 15 minutes.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm also excited for it, because whatever excited Disney about it, because they inherited this game basically when they bought Fox. We have an interview with one of the leads of Disney Games, and they were like, seeing them, their work on the Avatar game was the reason they wanted them to do the Star Wars game that Massive is also working on. So, you know, hopefully that speaks well to whatever way they're using the Ubisoft formula. But I'm excited for this one. Moving on from there, before we get to the big one, I do just want to briefly mention at Kickoff Live, we also saw a Death Stranding Director's Cut trailer that was very heavily, obviously, as someone who doesn't know the games, but I assume very heavily inspired as a goof from Metal Gear. With Sam Bridges being very confused about how to use a box to sneak around it if he can fit
trailer,
in that box.
That trailer was so good.
It was such a troll. And like, everyone was like on Twitter was like, Metal Gear crossed with Death Stranding. You know, everyone jumps to like the most extreme, and it's just not. He was just trolling, of course. But it was brilliant.
Yeah, I really do love the notion of a director's cut where this is the game that Kojima left Konami to make so that he could have directorial autonomy and make, and that somehow that game wasn't the director's cut. But, you know, maybe it's also just a fancy way to say DLC.
I'm exhausted from playing Devil's Advocate for maybe Kojima having a master plan on this game. It was definitely like, I was kind of let down by it. You know, I think it had some cool stuff in there, but it was like, I maybe was too close to it. That said, I'm really excited to see what Kojima does with PlayStation 5 and B, more time with the game. Because I felt like in a lot of ways it was kind of empty. Like, it also, I don't know, he built a studio from the ground up and then developed this game on a, you know, existing engine. And like, it never hurts to have some more time on a game and examine how players are actually engaging with it, especially a game like Death Stranding, which is, you know, heavily reliant on, you know, player cooperation. But also, like, you look at Kojima's track record for doing kind of follow-up games, like I guess you could say they are substantial in the Metal Gear substance sense. You know, he did Subsistence and you know, putting out basically like I wouldn't call those director's cuts, but they're kind of the Game of the Year edition. And it's like, oh, I mean, even going back to the first Metal Gear, there was the VR missions disc, which was like more of that game. And I guess with the sort of the structure of Metal Gear games, it's kind of hard because they're generally pretty tight narratively. It's kind of hard to drop like additional missions in there and have it not screw up the whole story or the game structure. But in the case of an open world game, there's like tons of room to throw in random stuff in that world. And like, just like, I don't know if there's going to be suddenly warehouses you've got to raid with stealth tactics and not use boxes like Norman Reedus is doing, apparently. It's cool.
Yeah. Do you think Norman Reedus did the mocap for this? Like, someone told him, okay, so you're going to pull this box down, you're going to look at it, and then I want you to jump in the box, stay in there for a couple seconds, then get out and just put the box back on the shelf.
I like to think so. I like to imagine that.
And I will say, Norman's just like, all right, you're the genius.
Depends on the pay track. But yeah, what's interesting about this one too, and one of the reasons I wanted to bring it up, I'm totally with you, Max. Like, I can't wait to see, like, I think there's a lot about the purpose of the game's gameplay to be so experiential, and the idea of the haptics and the adaptive triggers and the speaker and the 3D audio leading into that as well. Like, using the PS5 in interesting ways with this game feels like it could really add a lot to the experience. We'll definitely have to see. But the announcement also came with the tease that we'll get more info on it in a few weeks. And so everyone has naturally gone, oh, so the state of play is going to happen in a few weeks because we haven't gotten one yet, right? Do we all feel like that's kind of what this is indicating, or are we just going to get a, you know, Death Stranding cut trailer drop that's 10 minutes long and we're all hyping ourselves up for nothing?
I hope we get a state of play. I mean, I don't want to jump ahead to topics, but
totally.
You know, I think that we've heard a lot from everyone else in the last, you know, week or so. And I want to hear from Sony. I do. Like, I, you know, again, I don't want to jump ahead, but I want a state of play. I think that that would be great. And I would like to see more than just Death Stranding.
Totally.
Yeah, I mean, like last year we had the, what was it, the Future of Gaming PlayStation reveal, which I think was on, mm-hmm. I think it was June 11th or June 5th. It was
when E3 was.
Yeah, it was one of these one of these weeks. But it's odd to not have. I mean, we had that Horizon demo. Mm-hmm. If we get something, I hope it's another thing sort of akin to the Future of Gaming thing, where it's a bunch of, you know, it's a variety pack. It's a Toys R Us catalog rather than just a deep dive on Death Stranding. Because, like, for the most part, like, I'll totally mess with Death Stranding Director's Cut, but I don't need to keep track of every little new thing that's being added to it. I feel like that was exactly what screwed it up for me the first time, was analyzing those trailers frame by frame. So if I can just be like, not paying attention, and then, you know, go along, you know, like if they roll this into a presentation with other games, you know, I'll check my phone or something. I don't want to Kojima to spoil what happens if I pee on the ground in the game.
For sure. No, we'll see the end of whatever the director's cut footage is in the release trailer for that game, for sure. But of course, yeah, as I mentioned, I also do just want to shout out Hades is coming in August to PlayStation. If you haven't played Hades, for the love of Zeus, play Hades. It is just phenomenal. My girlfriend's now playing through it after she watched me play like 100 hours, and I can't wait to go back to that game again. But of course, yeah, I think the game we're all here to talk about, Elden Ring.
It
finally happened after, I guess it's been, what, 2 years since that reveal trailer at Xbox's E3 in 2019. We finally got gameplay and a January release date for the game. As Mitchell, you put, and I don't want to steal your thunder too much, but as you put in your sort of rewind of the trailer, we went from having zero Elden Ring info to having way too much Elden Ring info all of a sudden. It was like such a leap. And you in particular, you got to speak with Miyazaki from Software about Elden Ring and about, you know, everything we saw in the trailer, the things that it implied and the things that it showed off gameplay and story-wise. And so I wanted to start off with you just from like a general, you know, like top view of your discussion with Miyazaki. What were like your big takeaways from that discussion and the trailer sort of in tandem?
So my big takeaway is that with this game, the big thing that Miyazaki and FromSoft wanted to focus on is this feeling of freedom. And that manifests, I think, in a number of different ways. For one, it manifests in that this world is just absolutely huge. It seems bigger than anything that FromSoft has ever done, mostly in terms of like just how wide it is and the fact that you're actually using a horse to travel to different areas. So there's the freedom of exploration. There's also a freedom in how you approach combat situations, which they wanted to harp on. And I think the way that kind of takes hold is the fact that you're able to, there's like 100 weapon skills in the game, and you're able to take those weapon skills and you're able to apply them to whatever weapon you want. So you can mix and match that. Stealth is a much larger option than it has been in the past, with the exception of maybe Sekiro. Like it kind of, like I think we're going to see the way stealth is handled in this game. We can already kind of see that in the way it was handled in Sekiro. So that's like another aspect of it. And they also said that like there's parts where you can just like kind of get by an encounter if you don't want to deal with it. And whether that's by, you know, finding a way around, or, you know, using one of your enemy summons to find a way through. That's another thing. There's enemy summons in this game. So they didn't really talk too much about how you're actually able to get these summons, like whether it's something that you find or whether it's something like Neo, where every enemy you kill has a chance to drop like their soul or something. And then if they drop it, you get to use that as a summon. But yeah, you can summon enemies, and there's a whole variety of different enemies that you can use to help you out. And they all do different things. Miyazaki said, like, some of them aren't even that useful, but you might just like having them around, which I just think is really, really cool. So yeah, there's freedom. Basically, what I'm saying is freedom is a big part. And, you know, the word freedom in this context means a lot of different things. But yeah, it's really exciting. That's my biggest takeaway.
It was so great to read your review, or your interview, excuse me, your review of Elden Ring. Congrats on beating it already. I wouldn't put it
a review of Elden Ring, having not played any of Elden Ring.
I'm surprised the subreddit hasn't done that already. They're way ahead of the game over there.
That's very true. Yeah.
They've made all the lore already. But yeah, I did want to throw to everyone. As the newest Souls fan, I'm just excited to play this game. I think, you know, it looks amazing. It looks like more of what I have been enjoying about FromSoft games, but as longtime players and more storied players of this stuff, Lucy, I'll start with you. What really excited you about the Elden Ring footage we saw, other than it being there?
Right. I think for me, you know, as with all FromSoft games, the world and the enemy design is what intrigued me the most, and excited me the most. I think that FromSoft does weird enemy design better than anyone around, and I loved the amount of hands we saw on these enemies, and just how like utterly bizarre they've gone with them. And I also loved Miyazaki's description. Sorry, Mitchell, what were you
thinking? I was just going to say, I am going to walk so precariously around every single pot and vase in this game because of how those creepy little pot men started walking around.
Exactly. But, you know, I love Miyazaki's description of these enemies, and that especially the ones, you know, the big bosses who you encounter as you traverse the world, you know, have been tainted and tarnished by the power of the Elden Ring. And so there's kind of like this duality in them. You know, there's this once upon a time heroism that they still have. And then there's that twisted, you know, power. It's the kind of Smeagol Golem thing, right? And I love it as a concept. I love how it looks. It's just immediately one of these worlds where I just think I will lose hours and hours and hours in this world, like poking around every single little nook and cranny. Because why wouldn't you? I mean, look at it. It's just so stunning. And it's kind of wild to me because people, you know, on Twitter were saying things like, oh, it looks like a, you know, a last gen game and all this sort of thing. But like, I don't play FromSoft games for like their graphical prowess. I play them for their art design. I mean, that is what this game is giving to me in spades. Like, it looked so unlike anything else we were shown during E3. I just think it's beautiful.
If you're counting the pixels on the wallpaper, you're going to get killed. Like, it's not, don't look at it too hard, you know?
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Also, I think it kind of goes back to that article that Tom wrote that we always reference about next gen. You know, don't keep your expectations in check about next gen. We are still in a transitional period where, you know, the games are still going to be cross generation. Like, this game is still coming out on PS4 and Xbox One. Mm-hmm. So, if it looks like a last gen game, that's because it's going to be on last gen.
Yeah, but exactly. Lucy, I'm totally there with you. I as someone who's come to these games more recently, like I played Dark Souls Remastered this past year, and like, yes, it looks dated, but you get to honor Londo and you see the mm-hmm. the like majesty of it, but also like the sadness of it being so empty and everything. And it's like they know how to convey tone and mood and world like thematically in such great ways that to Max's point, like, you don't need to stand there and count the pixels of this stuff. Like, they clearly know what they're doing when it comes to character creation and world design and all this stuff. But Max, I didn't want to stop you from jumping in.
No, all good. I mean, the thing I'm getting from this, first of all, freedom, music to my ears, that sounds wonderful. Also, the fact that there's more than one ways around enemies. I love the FromSoft games I've played. I do sort of hate when there's just a bottleneck on a boss I'm stuck on, and it's like It's not like, oh, well, I'll go try another boss or I'll go do something else. It's kind of like you beat this guy or you don't get to eat your dessert. You don't go home. Like it's just, you can't go past him or whatever. And it sounds like they're taking a lot from Breath of the Wild. Like I'm reading into it too much, but in terms of just sort of that level of freedom and there being sort of an overworld and, different bosses scattered around and how you choose to approach them being fairly open. That sounds freaking awesome. And again, Breath of the Wild is a great example of how cutting edge graphics don't necessarily mean you're going to have a great game. So this is rad. There's some stuff like I'm trying not to look at it too hard because I want to be surprised. But again, I'm going to look at it because it's Elden Ring and it's gorgeous and it's awesome looking. I'm a little bit wary about the George R. R. Martin involvement. Like, I know he's not like, I don't think he's like scripting the whole thing. He's just kind of helped, create the world. But there was that bit saying that it's going to have a little bit less of an obtuse or an abstract story because of his involvement. And I was like, but I like the abstract. I like the sort of, that sense of kind of being an outsider in this world and having to piece it together yourself. To have like a, to have a Western author come in and help, I guess, punch that part up. I'm a little bit skeptical, but God, it looks cool. And also like Mitchell, it has co-op, right?
Yeah, that's one of the things that Miyazaki did confirm. One of the things that I feel bad that I didn't get to ask during the interview, and just because it didn't really come to me to think of it, I didn't get to ask about PvP, but co-op is definitely something that Miyazaki confirmed. In addition to being able to summon enemies as like AI companions, you can also still summon in buddies for co-op.
But Mitchell, I just want to say, I saw you copying a little bit of heat about not asking about PvP in the comments. You asked literally everything else. Yeah. And the fact that he answered your questions was incredible. I mean, the interview is so in-depth. If you haven't checked it out, please do. The full transcript is on IGN. And Mitchell also, as Dorno mentioned earlier, scripted a trailer breakdown as well that kind of contextualizes everything a lot more, and it's such a wonderful watch. So please check those out.
Definitely worth reading and watching all of the stuff from Mitchell's great interview. And just to touch on the George R. R. Martin stuff, Mitchell, I know you talked a little bit with Miyazaki about sort of the story and his involvement. Because to me, at least, like going into this and having heard his name attached to this the whole time, I always just assumed it was like he had a pitch meeting with them. They put his name on it because it helps like hype to a certain extent, and then moved on from there. But you got a little more like insight into the actual relationship of his involvement, right?
Yeah, it seems like so. The collaboration was basically George R. R. Martin came up with the world, the lore, the concept of the Lands Between, which is the world that Elden Ring takes in, and kind of like the history of what is kind of the spurring moment for the player character, which is basically the Elden Ring used to bless this land, and everyone who was in it was had been given grace by the Elden Ring, but there's a select few people that for whatever reason will probably learn over the course of the game lost that grace and were exiled from the Lands Between. They are known as Tarnished. Then, years later, a historic event happens and the Elden Ring breaks, shatters, its pieces go all over the place. They get picked up by these demigods that are essentially the six bosses of the game that have been kind of warped by the power of the Elden Ring, and kind of go into that dichotomy that Lucy was mentioning, where they're the heroes and the gods of the old world, but they're also corrupted by this power. And that shattering of the Elden Ring is what calls the player character, the Tarnished, back to the world. And it's kind of, that's kind of the setting of the beginning of the game, where you're brought back into the world by this force. And Miyazaki was kind of talking about how he wants the player to kind of think about what that return means to each individual person. So basically, to sum it all up, George R. R. Martin created the lore, the starting point, and then From Software has basically been turning that into a game, is kind of how I understand the collaboration.
Yeah, it was like a blueprint, right?
Yeah.
And then FromSoft just riffed on that blueprint. I see what Max is saying though as well. There was an answer where he said the characters are going to give you a little bit more, right, than the characters in previous games. So it's less about your own you know, sort of environmental storytelling and your own kind of assumption and theories of these characters, and potentially a little bit more overt. But he did also say that, you know, the storytelling in the periphery is something that is very much built into FromSoft's DNA, and that's not going anywhere. So it'll be really interesting to see how they tread that line. But I definitely still, from that interview, feel like it's going to be a FromSoft experience.
Yeah, and he kind of, like, you know, made that clear. Like, this is, you know, this is still the same style of storytelling within the margins. And I think as long as Miyazaki is making these games, it's going to be the same, because that's just how he enjoys experiencing these stories. He doesn't want to feed the player all the information. He wants the player to be able to go and discover things at their own pace. And even if they don't want to discover any of this lore, he wants them to have that choice too.
I think the biggest George R. R. Martin contribution is that several of the bosses are sleeping together, but they're also cousins.
There's also, unfortunately, they don't have the last third of the game.
There it is.
Anyway, I'm really excited for it. I can't wait to probably, even if I like understand the story, can't wait to go watch the 12-hour lore videos that will be on YouTube after the game comes out to like fully understand the world and everything. But yeah, I think like the thing that I took away from this trailer, and going back to like your original big takeaway, Mitchell, was just like the scope of this thing does feel like as large and as big an evolution as we were kind of all hoping it would be for their sort of not formula, but just like what they're known for and the way they approach their worlds and storytelling. Like a thing that I fell in love with, and I know that it's like the meme of it, but like in the original Dark Souls, is the way that everything feeds back on your central location, the way that everything connects together. And it was so cool. And so to have the idea that they're going with such an even larger world, but making all of these like distinct areas that will all connect and give you a lot of sort of world and character to explore in there. I'm really excited for this one. Yeah.
Yeah. And to be clear, like, you know, Dark Souls has always been a series that I've always viewed as having a lot of freedom, you know, itself. Like, that is a game where you can go in multiple different directions right from the start. You can't go everywhere, but the way it kind of, you know, points you to the proper path is by beating you if you go in a direction that it doesn't want you to go in. So if you go like to the graveyard right away, there's these super strong skeletons that will one shot you. But if you're good enough to be able to deal with that, you'll be able to get some really good loot if you go that way. So when I look at Elden Ring and I listen to what Miyazaki-san has said about it, what I imagine is just Dark Souls, but everything on a much higher scale. So like it's more open, there's more freedom, you know, more customization in terms of your builds, just everything on, you know, a higher level is kind of how I view what he's said about it so far.
I am going to be like talking to so many people during the playthrough of this game, because I know that somehow I'm going to screw it up and just like customize a really shitty build and then just be stuck with it, and the whole game will just be ruined for me. So I think this is very much going to be one of those games where like I'm just going to be constantly like texting Max, like texting you guys, just being like, you know, what are you playing as? Like, how are you evolving your character? Like, have you got any tips and tricks for me?
I'd be like, you must go into the labyrinth of Tyne and get the forbidden fetlock to put on your horse.
The sword of Gartholomew will imbue you with all the strength you need.
Exactly. But that's, you know, that's one of the reasons why I love playing these games, right? Because there's so much discovery and so much, like, there's no, even, you know, even you're sort of playing Dark Souls 3, like, there's still no real kind of roadmap. Like there's still stuff to be discovered in every new FromSoft game. So yeah, there's going to be a lot of texting.
I think this is going to be basically my first proper FromSoft game at launch. Like I don't know. I guess I'd try to give Sekiro a shot, but like that's the thing about that game is that I feel like that was very much for people who are really good at games. Whereas I think the other ones you definitely can cheese a lot more. And there's like a little bit more, I don't know. I don't know what I'm saying here, but
No, Max, you're right. Yeah. It's like you can sort of like, and this is the way that I feel, like some people can play through a FromSoft game and end up like just completely clean and polished and heroic and like flourished into a beautiful kind of demigod. And then there's players sort of like more like you and me who end up like at the end of it, just like, like we've been dragged through like a series of bushes like full of thorns, and we're just like all our clothes are torn and our hair's all crazy and we've got like thorns sticking out of us, but you know, we still got there in the end, right?
Yeah, you're just like, I live, damn it.
No, I mean, like, in the same way that, you know, this game unfolds in this kind of playground logic sort of way where you have to talk to other people about it to figure out what stuff does. I think the summon system is also kind of like asking a big brother to come help you fight a boss. Like, it's kind of got that level of, I mean, obviously it's over the internet, but it's that level of like, you know, maybe you want someone to lend a hand. So ring a little bell or eat that crystal or whatever it is you do in this
ring
one.
Ring a little bell. Ring your little bell.
I hope you put a ring on every time. Yeah.
But only to your cousin, who is actually a 17-handed carriage that is pulled by ogres. one thing about the structure of the game, sorry, I just wanted to add, but like, Mitchell, what you were saying about it being open, you're totally right, but I feel like the way they're structured is typically like, it's like hallways and paths, you know? Like, you start in one room, and there's like five different ways you can leave it, and then that stuff branches out, and some of it circles back. In this case, we're seeing a lot of fields. Like, we're seeing a lot of wide open areas, and I get the sense that maybe the approach here has been like, all right, here's the field. Let's put like buildings and doors and caves and dungeons and stuff in this field. And then obviously stuff between those things. It's, you know, I think it's still very much going to have the FromSoft approach, but I hope that it's as opposed to going north or south, you're like, well, maybe I want to go at sort of like a 45 degree southeast angle and just wander off and see what's down this way, you know?
Yeah. So my understanding of the way this world is, did I interrupt you?
No, go ahead.
What I was just going to say, my understanding of the way this world is set up is that there's six lands that kind of make up the main bulk of the lands between, and you can't go to everyone at once. Like, there is an order, but within each of those lands, there's like a mainline dungeon that kind of is, you know, your main destination. And then alongside of that, there's like castles, catacombs, and other optional areas that you can explore, and usually will have like some sort of really cool reward, like weapons, maybe a magic spell, et cetera, et cetera. So that's kind of the structure of it. And then Miyazaki also said that there is a hub world, or a hub area that connects you to all six of these areas, but it's not accessible right from the start.
But it's not, you know, it's not like Demon Souls where it's like you which portal do you want to go through or whatever.
Definitely not.
Yeah.
That's definitely a bit more of a limited structure than it seems like we're going with here. Yeah. I am immensely excited for this. I have a feeling we'll be talking a lot more about Elden Ring in the months to come if we see more. If not, we'll be talking about it a ton in January because the game has a release date for January, which is kind of nuts. But we'll definitely keep an eye on it. But yeah, as we said, go check out Mitchell's interview. Go check out the trailer rewind breakdown of it all. There's a lot of great info in there if you haven't seen it already. Moving on, before we sort of talk about what we've been playing, I do want to touch briefly on sort of a thing that Lucy was alluding to earlier, which is just a general, like, now that we are past E3, we're recording this literally the day after E3 has ended, PlayStation wasn't there. This is not a new thing for them. They skipped 2019. They've sort of clearly wanted to, you know, stake out their own path. But this was sort of a, you know, the industry coming back together sort of year was what I think this E3 was trying to accomplish. But PlayStation set out. Lucy, I want to start with you. Do you feel like that was the right move? Also, I'm going to briefly be off camera, but don't worry, I'm still here and listening.
Okay. Yes. I mean, the right move is kind of not really like... it's neither the right move or the wrong move. I think that, you know, E3 is kind of increasingly becoming, it has been for a long time now, and it felt more like this year than ever before, just completely disjointed. And I don't think that Sony needs to be there. I don't think that anyone really needs to be at E3 anymore. I think that, like, you know, Nintendo does its directs and Xbox has its I forget what they call them, state of plays, or no, that's Sony, inside showcases Xbox. Yeah. Inside Xbox, right? And you know, people can do digital events whenever they want, right? And like, I sort of feel like Sony has made its kind of footprint now with state of play, and I think we just need to continue to see state of plays, right? Like, I don't think, even though there's so much attention paid to E3, and like, I'm not negating that, I just don't think it has the relevancy to publishers anymore that it did even, you know, I'm not even talking like it hasn't had relevancy to publishers for a while now, I would say. Not a huge amount, not especially not like it used to. And while it's really cool to see, you know, the big Xbox showcase and the big Nintendo showcase and Direct, that was cool, but like they could do that at any time. You know, and like, I just don't think Sony needs to be there. Yeah, I mean, it was still, I still want Sony to talk to me. I mean, you know, I'm a PlayStation person, and I want more news and trailers and all that sort of thing. I just don't think E3 is like, I don't think they need to be there, essentially. That's my long-winded take.
No, I very much understand where you're coming from. It's one of those things I think the Xbox conference, I just put out a tweet genuinely curious about how people felt. And there was a couple like through lines of thought about people's feelings of whether or not Sony should have been there or not. And it kind of boiled down to either, no, they didn't need to be there because like you were saying, they can command the stage whenever they want to. Like I'm pretty sure their concurrence on the PS5 showcases last year both like trounced any of the shows at E3 this year. Like they, and probably most state of plays where they're going to show God of War or Horizon will do that. They just have that cachet right now. And I think whether or not that's the right move to be sort of like isolated from everyone, they know they can do that. But another interesting thread that I saw developing was a lot of people also saying E3 is supposed to be this moment for everyone coming together. And so I wish they were here because they should be here alongside everyone else. And it's an interesting thing of like, that is sort of the reason people enjoy E3 and the coming together of every different group, you know, within the industry, no matter what platform you're playing on or whatnot. But I don't like PlayStation just doesn't see the reason to play by those rules at the moment, for better and worse. Max, what did you think about their decision to?
I mean, I totally get it. I wish there was, a little more, hey, the lights are on kind of thing, like maybe drop a little state of play that's about more than just Horizon, you know, in advance or whatever. I mean, I think we're probably going to get something this summer at some point. I'd be very surprised if we didn't. But yeah, I mean, E3 is kind of like, E3 is like high school reunions when everyone's friends on Facebook. And if you want to go to your high school reunion and announce that you're pregnant, you could do that. I mean, if you're pregnant, you know, that's great news. But people are going to be kind of sidetracked with whatever else is going on. Whereas if you pick like a random Thursday, hop on Facebook and go, guess what, everybody, we're pregnant. People are going to be like, oh, crap, that's awesome. But like, it's kind of like we talk about like E3, like it's a great place. Everybody comes together and it's like it's a trade show. You know, like mm-hmm. Everybody coming together is incidental. It's a place for companies to show what they hope to sell in 5 months. Like mm-hmm. It serves financial purposes. And like the, you know, companies pay obscene amounts of money to have booths on the show floor. And I can't imagine that really seems like if you manage to, you know, get through 2020 and still get people excited about your games and get in front of investors and, you know, like games definitely didn't suffer last year, despite there being no E3. So maybe the company's, I don't know, saving a few million bucks on, you know, those giant banners that go across the entire convention center and maybe spending that on the game itself or just, I don't know, buying their employees better chairs at home. Like, I don't know what actually goes on, but it's just, it's sort of, I mean, E3 as a industry gathering is obsolete. I think having gaming events for fans, there's still plenty of room for that. And obviously, you know, Gamescom is a perfect example of that. It's grown, you know, exponentially since it first started. But yeah, like as far as a trade show, like E3, I don't think knows what it wants to be exactly. And that's pretty much demonstrated by what we saw this last week. Like, I feel like the amount of information that was on display could have been compressed into probably two pretty tight days, but it was kind of spread out a lot more than that.
Yeah. And like, we definitely saw some really muddy, like, showcases. You know, Capcom's was just, what was that? You know, like, what was the point of that? And I felt so bad for the host on stage. I mean, she wasn't on stage, but, like, the host kind of having to lift up this kind of fairly redundant content. And, you know, Square Enix wasn't a hell of a lot better. It just felt like they were scrambling to show something where they didn't need to, where it could have been done in much more elegant ways. And it felt like trying to recapture something that just can't be recaptured. I know that sounds really like a hell of a lot, like it's like a bummer of a statement, but I was just watching it. I was just like, what is this? Who is this for? You know?
As we're recording this, you're reading through the bummer of a statement that I've written for the website. That'll go up at some point. But yeah, it's that strange thing of there is an absolute magic to everyone being together. But I think Max, you make the really good point of like us all being together and going through, you know, in the trenches of the war room to cover all the shows and everything is not just an E3 thing. That can happen at Gamescom, that can happen at another show. And all of the conferences this year, I think to Lucy's point earlier, Microsoft and Nintendo could have done those showcases any time of year, and it would have probably had just as big an impact. And
they were Capcom both great conferences. I want to say, like, they were both really good. Like, I'm not complaining. Yeah. Like, there were some duds, but Microsoft and Nintendo had great showcases.
Yeah, and Capcom and Square, I think they felt the pressure to be E3 showcases, but didn't have the things to make an E3 showcase. And not that the games that were shown were in any way bad. It was just the fact that like they put too much into a show that had too few games.
I have a theory. I have a theory about this. I believe that the reason Capcom and Square's showcases suffered is that they have stuff that Sony wants to show off.
I did want to bring this up.
Okay. Yeah. If you look back at it, Resident Evil Village, Final Fantasy 16, both revealed during the PlayStation 5 announcement. I imagine when you make a deal for something like that, it's not just a one-off instance. It's kind of like, you know, we've got a brand new AAA game. It's going to be cross-platform. But which platform do you want to, you know, align it with marketing-wise? That's always the case. We see this all the time. I feel like we're going to see, like we saw the Final Fantasy 7 reveal on a Sony stream. We didn't see that on a Square Enix stream. Like that was on Sony's big, you know, PlayStation presentation. And I think it's a little weird that we did have that Square presentation with like major stuff noticeably absent, with not even like a passing mention to it. And then Capcom's Resident Evil thing, which made me literally burst out laughing because it was the marketing equivalent of when I go, oh, hey, sorry, just seeing this got buried in my inbox. Like they know that Resident Evil 8 sold, and I feel like they probably knew they were going to make DLC. So to be like, I missed this notification. Yeah, we'll get right on that. You know, sure thing. We wrote in the text, forgot to hit send. Crazy, right?
Those two in particular, I'm totally with you. It's on the Square side, like you said, there was not a passing mention of 16 and Forspoken or anything about 7 Remake, even though the DLC was coming out this week. Like they really just didn't. It might have been in there for a split second. Forgive me if it was, but like they really didn't focus on any of the future of all those big games. Capcom, literally, other than the two games really that they showed off, Ace Attorney and Monster Hunter Stories 2, they don't have any other announced games than Pragmata, which was shown at that first PS5 showcase. They didn't mention it during this thing at all either. We were in a very weird place where Sony probably has some agreements to have the first, you know, the first right of refusal or showcase for those types of games. Mitchell, how did you feel about sort of Sony's absence? I want to make sure you get a chance.
I think it's kind of setting the kind of stage for a lot of other developers to kind of also make this maybe exit from E3. The Capcom, Square, and Bandai Namco only showed the Dark Pictures anthology on their thing. It really felt like there was some sort of business agreement that these companies were all kind of just satisfying by doing the least possible thing that they can do. Like, you know, if you think of what are the least exciting announcements that Capcom can put forth for an E3, I would say it's Ace Attorney and Monster Hunter Stories. Not to, you know, shame those games, they're great, but it's not the kind of thing that really gets people excited when you have things like Street Fighter 6, you know, Dragon's Dogma 2, all these other games that people are pretty sure Capcom is working on. So to me, it just felt like they were doing the bare minimum of their contractual obligation to be at E3. And they have, like Max said, they're saving some of the other stuff for something else, whether that's, you know, Sony showcase, whether that's their own showcase. I don't know. It just, this was a weird E3. It kind of felt like the end of an era almost. And, you know, maybe next year we'll see the beginning of something else, whether it's Summer Game Fest or, you know, just a bunch of developers doing their own events.
I wonder if, like, Microsoft's doing a games showcase extended director's cut
upgrade
or whatever. Like, I wonder if this is Microsoft testing the waters to see what happens if you do have an event outside of E3, because E3 effectively over. The Bandai Namco stuff was weird. Like the Dark Pictures thing, that was announced during Xbox, right?
This was a separate event that happened, yesterday.
I saw that one, but that game had already been announced previously.
Oh, yeah, right? It's
been known for a little while. I think that event was originally listed on the E3 site as just Bandai Namco Presents. And then they clarified that it was just that game because were getting their hopes up.
Yeah. We've seen for years now, Bandai Namco is kind of they've buddied up with Microsoft, and we get their big sort of licensed anime game reveals during those streams, like whether it's, you know, Jump Force or DBZ Kakarot or whatever. So I wonder if we're going to see, like, I wonder if the thing tomorrow is going to be extended looks at the stuff that Microsoft already showed, or if there's going to be some new stuff sprinkled in there, and, you know, they get to see how much mileage it gets, or it just didn't fit in the existing, you know, allotted time they had previously.
I mean, we know during that show that, like, Ninja Theory will be there, and Hellblade wasn't at the conference, so we're likely to see some stuff there that wasn't at their show. But yeah, I do think you're totally right. I think it's definitely them testing the waters, especially now that they own the Microsoft Theater next door. Like at E3 2019, they moved off the show floor and put their showings over there. So we're in a very weird transitional period. I think PlayStation skipping made a lot of sense, but what it means for the future, I think it'll raise a lot of questions that we'll see kind of play out in the months and year to come. As we sort of get into wrap up of things, I do also briefly want to mention there is an unboxing on IGN of the two new DualSense controllers. I apologize if you can see some flecks of a paper towel that I used to try to wipe one off so you didn't see handprints. But these are the two new DualSense colors. This is the Midnight Black and the Cosmic Red. I was all in on the Midnight Black before they were released because I thought it looked like a DualSense, it looked like a DualShock, but a DualSense. But I've actually really grown to love the Cosmic Red. It's weirdly, the lighting betrays it, but it's actually more of a, like, a berry red. It's sort of a warmer red than like the Spider-Man PS4 PlayStation Special Edition was. I actually really, really like this color a lot in terms of, like, the first DualSense that they've shown off. I actually really love this one. I don't know why it's $5 more. It's $5 more expensive than the Midnight Black for some reason.
The red, they have to crush up with the red pigments to get it in there. What is that's true, not that remotely is, cosmic. They should have called that like exotic gentleman's pool table red. Like, what is that?
It's both of the colors, and sorry, you can see the flex there. Both of them are like, it's Midnight Black and Cosmic Red to be like space themed. I don't know why. That has nothing to do with what I think of PlayStation, but nonetheless, they are cool colors that you can go check out, like a close up unboxing of on IGN. So definitely go check that out if you are interested in picking one of those up. Before we wrap up, I do just want to mention briefly, Mitchell, you reviewed the Final Fantasy VII Remake Episode Intermission DLC. Is that the name? Is that the correct name?
Final Fantasy VII Remake Integrated Episode Inter, it's all capitalized, Mission.
I'm used to Kingdom
Featuring Hunt, Yuffie, so. Arcade Edition.
It's not a surprise to me that that's what they went with. I'm about halfway through it. I finished chapter one, and I am amazed I even did that because I couldn't stop playing Fort Condor. But I just wanted you to give your brief thoughts on the DLC.
This is a really good DLC. You know, it is kind of short in terms of the actual story content. You can probably get through it in about 4 hours if you don't spend all your time in Fort Condor, which you should because Fort Condor is awesome. But yeah, I think, you know, Yuffie is kind of the star of the show here. She's just an awesome character. She's adorable. She's hilarious. She's like supremely confident in everything she does, which is just really funny to watch. And she's just kind of a badass. And then also, you know, you got Sonon, who's a really cool new character that they add as well. And they got a really good dynamic of like almost, you know, big brother, little sister. The big protective brother who's like just like constantly flabbergasted how, you know, headstrong and crazy Yuffie is. So yeah, it's a really fun DLC. They added a new combat style for Yuffie, which I described in my review as being like they just dropped a Platinum Games character in Final Fantasy VII Remake. She's got like you get rewarded for doing a perfect block in that you can completely negate damage. So like if you're really, really good, you can like, you know, wreck people even without having, you know, the level up advantage just by blocking all their attacks. You have like a special dodge that if you use it at the right time, you gain your ATB back. So it's very action game heavy, which I obviously really like. This is a Mitchell Saltzman game, as Max would say.
You are eating well at the moment, my friend.
I am eating very well right now. This was a lot of fun. A lot of comments are like, well, why don't you give it a 9 then? And I think the reason for that is that it is just a 4-hour experience for the mainline game. And even though there are these great side activities I highly recommend checking out, you know, the quality of the 4 hours you have when you're playing the main game and the quality that you have when you're playing the rest of it, they're not exactly the same. Even though it's still worth going through, you know, the real meat of the DLC is that 4-hour experience. I think it's great. It's just not, you know, an absolutely amazing kind of thing by nature of it just being DLC. I wish this was a full game. I wish Yuffie was part of the main cast. And God, I cannot wait for part 2 of Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Well, you'll definitely have to wait, most likely. I think it's worth saying you're calling it great. Like, it is really great DLC. I'm playing through it. It is very sort of like, not in a bad way because the combat is so great, but also in somewhat of a criticizing way. Like, it is pretty repetitive in terms of like, it is essentially just like, especially the second half is like a lot of just challenge room after challenge room after challenge room. Like, it is very, it is not that like interestingly paced, I think, like, moment to moment of like the scenarios they're introducing you to, but like as you were saying, the core combat with Yuffie is so fun that it makes that a really pleasant experience. That's at least how like I've been taking it so far.
For sure.
But yeah, like you said, the side stuff is so fun. Please, Square, if you're listening, I will pay good money to play a Fort Condor spinoff. It probably would be free to play and you'd have crazy monetization. I would sadly probably indulge. It's really fun. If you play the DLC, don't skip on that mini game because it's a lot of fun. But unfortunately, we're pretty much out of time. We can definitely tune in the coming weeks because it'll be a little lighter to talk about some of the stuff we've been playing otherwise. But before we leave, you can find us all on Twitter. I'm at JM Dornbush. Mitchell is at Jurassic Rabbit. Lucy is at Luce O'Brien. And Max is at Max Scoville. Mitchell, is there anything else other than your Final Fantasy review, your Miyazaki interview, and all the other amazing stuff you've been doing during E3 you want to point people toward?
I don't have it up yet, but if you're interested in that playthrough that I was talking about for the Final Fantasy Origins demo, I'm going to have a gameplay video of that up on the IGN YouTube channel and IGN.com.
Awesome. So Lucy, anything you want to point people to from this crazy God. Week?
Well, it's just, it's still ongoing, isn't it? It is. I mean, you know, any of our trailer breakdowns, any of our op-eds, we've spun out a lot. Dorno, you've got a big piece going up that will hopefully be up by the time this goes live. So much stuff.
It's a lot.
It's just been a lot of content. We've got roundups, you know, yeah, just heaps of footage breakdowns and stuff like that.
And Max, what about you?
Last summer, Brian and I did a very silly Maneater Let's Play where we were dressed like fishermen, and apparently the people at Tripwire liked it and they had us do it again, but with knight costumes. So we played around in Chivalry 2 and we're throwing roast chickens at each other and flying off the catapults and had like a legitimately good time. So go check that out. It's very silly. That's a very fun game. So.
Yeah. Living your best life.
Exactly. And yeah, as Lucy said, there's a ton of like big feature breakdown stuff that is still continuing to go up on IGN from across the team. Everyone's doing incredible work. So please go check all of that stuff out on IGN and YouTube. But in the meantime, that is going to wrap us up for this week's episode of Podcast Beyond. Thank you, Mitchell. Thank you, Lucy. And thank you, Max, for joining me for this week's episode. And thank you, as always, to Red, our producer, for making this show happen and listening to our shenanigans. And thank you, of course, to everyone out there listening and watching. We hope you're safe. We hope you're well. And as always, Beyond.
Yeah.
Beyond.
Beyond.